Chapter 2, verse 1, but the emphasis is going to be placed upon verses 9 and 10. I'm going to go through the entire passage, and I've got some points for each verse, but I just want to give this main thought this morning of God, I mentioned, I neglected to mention in announcements just a few minutes ago, so let me do that now. I have somewhere to be right at 12:30 this afternoon myself personally, not my whole family, but I do. And so I'm going to be leaving quickly after the service. I love you. I'll shake hands if you're in my path from here to the car. But I have somewhere I have to be by 12:30. And so don't think that the preacher is mad that he got a divorce and his wife kicked him out or anything like that. I just have somewhere I got to go. And then we'll be back tonight, 5 o'clock. So I'll be here early. If you want to come on back 5 o'clock tonight, we'll have our normal service with no time frames for me at all in any way, shape, or form. And so anyway, I just wanted you to know that. And you went, where's the preacher going? Why is he squealing wheels out of the parking lot? And I just wanted you to know that. Let's get into it this morning. 1 Peter chapter 2. Father, help me now, I pray. Please use this time for you. I pray you'd use me, and I ask and beg for it. Lord, I need you. There's nothing I can give of myself, Lord. There's no wisdom I can share of my own. God, I need thee. And Father, please use this time for thy sake. I pray in Christ's name. Amen. The word of is a preposition. It describes relationship. It describes a part of to form something complete. Okay? So a small two-letter word, O-F, of, is a preposition that takes a part to make a whole. It finishes something. It finishes a thought. It finishes a place, a destination. It arrives a conversation, a sentence, something grammatical, and takes it to an end in which you can think of and relate to. You with me so far? I know it's mind-blowing already that early, right? God, you're thinking quick, fast, and hurt. It means a part to make a whole, and it's found 18,201 verses in Scripture, the word O-F. It's found 18,201 verses. Not only is it found 18,201 verses, it is found 34,755 times in Scripture. In Genesis, we find the phrase of God, of waters, of the heaven, of the air, of the earth, of the sea, of knowledge, of the tree, of good, of the ground, of evil, etc., etc., etc. Remember, 34,000 times. I'm not giving you all 34,000. But you can take the general phrase and recognize in each instance when God is using it of God. He's saying He's saying the knowledge of God. But then he says the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Of knowledge of good and evil. Which tree? Of knowledge. Of what kind of knowledge? Good and evil. So OF, of, describes a part of to complete the phrase. You with me? Everybody stand so far? Good. In the history portion of Scripture, which is the books of Joshua through Esther, it describes of Moses, of the Lord, of Israel, of thy life, of a good courage, of the people. You seeing the trend so far? In the books of wisdom, which is the book of Job, all the way through the Song of Solomon, talks about the sons of God, of his hands, of the people, of the sword, of the house, of the mother's womb, of the foolish, of the wise. All of these, OF, small phrase, using the preposition to relate something in part to make a whole. You with me? Because I'm going somewhere. Stay with me. Throughout the Gospels, we have the preposition being used mostly to describe a certain people or a certain place. Of God, of Samaria, of a certain place, of Paul, of Apollos. We just see different scriptures of, OF, describing a person or a place. Throughout the books of Paul, we see it being used of Christ, of God, of the Son of God. The word of is so small, yet so powerful. Of something. I would be the son of my mother. A part of to complete. You with me?
Sure.
You would be a member of New Life Baptist Church if you were a member of New Life Baptist Church. I am a member of. You are a part that would make a complete of New Life Baptist Church. A word strong enough to relate the dust of the ground to the God of the universe. Wow. Simply to complete the thought of his awesomeness, his fullness, and his sovereignty. Yes, to think that you personally are the dust of the ground, formed and shaped to become a child of God.
Amen.
You follow? You stay with me so far? I see the wheels turning, so that's good. As we get into the book of 1 Peter, we see a provoking passage. This passage pokes its little finger in many a ways, in our eyeballs and in our chest. You know, sometimes when a daddy wants to get a point across to his son, he takes that little finger and he just pokes a little bit and just says, you need to pay attention, you need to look up, you need to listen here, right?
Sure.
Peter is teaching the people of God to be a holy people. Peter's not just coming giving a Sunday morning message. Peter's not just coming to give the next devoted time of service. He's coming with a point. And the point is, he needs the people of God to actually live a life of God.
Amen.
Holy.
Yep.
Peculiar people, it calls it. He's doing his best to describe the holiness and righteousness of God so that the people of God would live accordingly. He's trying to describe how magnificent God is, and then reminding the people that they are people of God.
Yes, sir.
You following?
Yes, sir.
So he is trying to encourage us and saying, you, as a Christian, are a part to complete a whole.
Amen.
Of God.
Yes, sir.
You there? Mm-hmm. Take the passage, look at the passage, if you would. Where most Christians fail in being Christians is that they are trying to live godly unto themselves, but that will never work. You cannot live a godly life unto a fleshly goal.
Yes, sir.
Did you hear me? You will never live a godly life unto a fleshly goal. You may live a godly life unto what you think is a godly life.
Right.
But in actuality, it's just a good moral standard in which you've developed.
Right.
But that just because it is good doesn't mean it is godly. Amen. I can do good.
Amen.
And not be godly.
Right.
It is possible. In order to live godly, one must do so unto the end of the Son of God as a measuring stick. If I'm going to live godly, I'm not measuring myself against Bobby Francis. I'm measuring myself against the Son of God. If I'm going to live godly, I'm not measuring myself against my neighbor. I'm not measuring myself against my family. I'm not measuring myself against my pastor. If I'm going to live godly, then the measuring stick is not going to be my standard. And it's not going to be your standard. There is only one standard in which we can measure to when we're living godly. And that standard is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You staying with me?
Yeah.
Good. When we focus, listen, this is a good point right here. Thought of this all on my own with the Lordship. When we focus on living right and good to the end of a mankind, we miss 80% of what the Lord has for us. When I'm simply trying to live right, and I'm simply just trying to live good, and I'm just trying to be, hey, a good old American boy, right? I just want to live godly, what I think is godly. Right. Do right. I don't want to do wrong by nobody. I just want to work hard. I want to pay my portion. I want to do my part, and I just want to be a good citizen of the United States of America. Hey, that can all be commended. Hallelujah. Praise God that you want to be a good person.
Amen.
But to live godly.
Yes, sir.
That's a whole nother realm.
Right. Amen.
That's a whole nother part. We fail God and we fail ourselves when simply trying to live right and good. And I'm putting quotations around right and I'm putting quotations around good. Because what you would measure as right and good are not only and simply the things that God would measure as right and good. Are you following me? What you would put out as good, God would say, that's table stakes.
Right.
What you would put out as acceptable, God would say, no, no, no. Your righteousness is as filthy rags.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Right.
So you and I would measure and say, oh, I did a good deed today. Oh, I done something good for the neighborhood. Or, oh, man, I fulfilled, you know, I gave blood to the Red Cross. Hallelujah for yourself, but that doesn't mean you're godly.
That's right.
Amen.
Are you following?
Yes, sir.
When we focus on living right and good to God's end, we may never obtain it, but we will have God's personal touch. If I'm trying to live godly, I may never obtain perfectness, and I won't until I get to glory, but when I'm attempting to live godly, not just good,
right,
but when I'm attempting to live godly, I have God's personal touch on what I do.
Yes, sir.
If I'm just trying to do right, anybody can do that. Any old Southern Maryland boy can just do right. And there's a lot of good folk around here. And they're just doing right, but that doesn't mean they're godly.
Right.
You with me?
Yes, sir.
Let's look at the passage together. 1 Peter chapter 2. I wrote this. I got ahead of myself a little bit here. I wrote this passage. Don't turn there. Just listen as I wrote this passage down. That would be helpful to us. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, you can mark it down, but I don't want you to turn there. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 23. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. What did all that just say for those of you that tuned out after word number two? Paul said, there are a lot of good people out here trying to do a lot of good things.
Right.
That's what he said. There are a lot of good people around you. There are a lot of Christians trying to do a lot of good things. And they're real good at being a member of society. They're real good in their community. They're real good at their workplace. They're real good in their neighborhood. They're real good people. But they're trying to obtain praise from the man beside them.
That's right.
Not focusing nor paying attention to the God,
yes, sir,
who created them. They strive for a mastery. They strive to do right. And they're temperate in those things and they're getting them done. And praise God for that. However, he said, I'm obtaining, I'm striving for an incorruptible crown.
Amen.
I'm not just trying to do good by you. I'm not just trying to do good by my neighbor. I'm trying to do good by God.
Yes.
Amen.
Big difference. We have so many folks, Southern Maryland is full of good people who could care less about living godly.
Amen.
Right.
Good people.
Right.
Solid people. Helpful people. Hands involved. Working. Trying to do right. But you mentioned God.
Right.
And you mentioned living godly.
Yes, sir.
And there's some people that don't want to make that decision.
Amen.
Now pay attention. Follow me now. So Peter is describing to a certain people how to be a certain people. Okay? So let's look at who that certain people is. Don't fail yourself by reaching for the wrong finish line. I'm not just trying to get out of this thing a good person. I want to strive to live my life as a godly person. You with me?
Sure.
I'm not trying to get to the end of my days and say, oh, he lived a good life. Because if I do that, I'm missing 80% of what the Lord has for me. But if I try to live a godly life with God's personal touch on me, then he has a whole lot more for me than I can see with my own eyes. Look at the passage. Here we get into it. Verse 1. Excuse me. Wherefore, the Bible says, wherefore lay aside all laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings. I wrote this down right here. Verse 1 and 2. Verse 2, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. I put this word, write this down. Verses 1 and 2 show us the purpose. So we've got Peter trying to teach a certain people how to be a certain people. You with me?
Sure.
Hey, some of y'all ain't with me. I'm going to start hooping and hollering, doing cartwheels. I'm going to have to start breaking something around here because y'all are dozing off. Pay attention if you're in church house on Sunday morning. Pay attention to the word of God.
Glory. Amen.
Don't pay attention to me. Pay attention to what God has for you. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings, as newborn babes, here's the purpose, desire the sincere milk of the word that ye may grow thereby.
Right.
So why is Peter trying to teach a certain people how to be a certain people? He's doing so, so that they may grow thereby. Everybody needs to learn. Mm-hmm. Nobody has arrived, and we all have work to do.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. If I'm a child of God, I will never obtain, I will never complete, I will never finish until I get to glory. And so it is my job to work towards that way so that I can learn and grow thereby.
Amen.
You with me? Verse 3. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. I wrote this down right here. Proof.
Yes, sir.
Verses 1 and 2, we see a purpose. Verse 3, we see proof that the Lord has already blessed us.
Yes, sir.
I am already a certain people. I have already been a part of a peculiar people when I got adopted into the family of God. The Lord is gracious, it says, is gracious. Verse 4. To whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. I put this, a prospect. So in verse 1, I see a purpose, verse 1 and 2. In verse 3, I see proof of what I've already been. Now, verse 4, I see a prospective place in which I can arrive. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Look at it again, verse 4. Stay with me now. Get something from the Word of God. To whom coming? Is Jesus coming?
Yes, sir.
Is there a prepared place for me in heaven?
Yes, sir.
I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And so verse 4 tells us, to whom coming, as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, his own received him not. You are a certain people of God, and as a certain people of God, there are too many certain peoples of God who keep God out, just like they did with Jesus Christ. Came unto his own, and his own received him not. So I see a purpose. I see a proof. I see a prospect. A place in which I'll obtain. Verse 4. Look at verse 5. Excuse me, the bottom half of verse 4. Disallowed indeed a man, but chosen of God and precious. I wrote this down. A precious prize. I've got a prospective place. And there I will receive a precious prize.
Amen.
I will get to spend all of eternity with Christ himself.
Amen.
What a prize. Hey, I want some big teddy bears at the carnivals. They don't compare.
Hey,
I've had some pretty good paying jobs, and that money runs out.
Yes,
I've had some good people in life and good friendships and family that the Lord has blessed with, but none of them hold a candle to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So there is a prospective place, and there is a precious prize in which I can obtain. Peter, getting all the P's this morning, Peter is trying to teach a certain people how to be a certain people.
Amen.
And he said, look, there's a purpose. He said, look, Christ has already given you proof. Look, I got ahead of myself when I said proof. There is a prospective place, and now there is an obtainable precious prize in which you'll acquire. All right, verse 5. I'm breaking it down real easy for you here. You ain't even got to read the passage to understand the scripture, I hope. Verse 5. Ye also. Is that personal?
Sir.
He said, ye.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices, acceptable to who?
God.
What does it say? God by who?
Jesus Christ.
Did it say acceptable to your neighbor?
No,
sir.
Did it say acceptable to mom?
No,
sir.
Did it say acceptable to your brother?
No.
It said acceptable to God.
Amen.
Be careful when you think you've done good, lest to measure up that stick with Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not measure up that stick against Brother Eddie. You'll fall short.
Yes, sir.
I just want to keep him paying attention.
Yes,
don't measure it up against a preacher. You'll fall short.
Amen.
You take what you have to offer God and measure it to Christ.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Don't look at my tithe record and think you've done good.
Mm-hmm.
Look at God's giving record and see what you've done.
Amen.
You follow me?
Amen.
So I have here in verse 5 a present presentation. Personally, present now.
Amen.
We are to present ourselves. Verse 5, look at it. Ye also, as lively stones, present tense, not past tense, present tense, are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. We have a personal responsibility to give a present personal application and present ourselves,
yes, sir,
sacrificially.
Yes, sir.
If I'm going to live godly, if I'm going to be a certain type of people, then I need to present myself sacrificially for the one who sacrificed for me.
Amen.
Are you following?
Yes, sir.
I'm going somewhere with this. Y'all pay attention now. I got good stuff here for you. I promise you, you're going to be like, oh, wait a minute, if you just hang in there with me. So we got a present presentation, a current event of sorts. We are responsible, required, expected to present ourselves to Jesus daily.
Yes, sir.
I die daily. I present myself daily. So what's Peter doing? He's teaching a certain people how to be a certain people. And one of the ways he presents that is presently, now. Not future, not
right.
Tomorrow,
right.
Not later, now. All right? Look at verse 6. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Sion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. And he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallow, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. I put this, a profound problem. Peter is trying to teach a certain people how to be a certain people, but herein lies a problem which prevents them from being a certain people. What is the problem that presents them from being a certain people? Look at it. Wherefore it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Sion a chief cornerstone precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you therefore which believe, he is precious. But here's the problem. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient. What prevents a certain people from being a certain people? They neglect the scriptures.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Wow.
They neglect the scriptures.
Amen.
You look at it, you read it, you hear it.
Right.
But we fail to apply it.
Help us.
And so we take God for the get out of hell free card.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
But then we fail to present ourselves as a daily sacrifice.
Yes, sir.
As Christ has presented himself to us as a daily sacrifice. When Christ died for you, did he just die for your today?
No.
He died for your tomorrow.
Amen.
Amen. And so every day that sacrifice applies. Every day. What can you do personally to sacrifice for Christ daily?
Right.
You'll never be able to give enough. So have you acquired? Have you obtained? Is there a certain place that you've reached that you can say, "Why, I don't give anymore"?
Right.
Not of money. I'm talking about of right. yourself. I'm right. talking about of your heart.
Right.
Is there a certain place which you say, "Ah, that's enough. I've given too much. Oh, I've given not enough." So we have all the P's so far. We have a purpose. We have a proof. We have a prospect. We have a precious prize. We have a present presentation. We have a profound problem. But now let's look at verse 9. But ye, is that personal?
Sure.
You're looking at it? But ye are a chosen generation. Amen. Ye are a royal priesthood. Ye are a holy nation.
Yes, sir.
Ye are a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous yes. light. Which in time past were not a people, but are now
right.
the people, here's that word that we're building up to,
right.
of God.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
We got all of the scriptures, 34,755 times the word of is mentioned, and every time it's mentioned, it's describing a part to complete a whole. And here you are in 1 Peter chapter 2, you personally being applied as an of God. You complete God.
Wow.
Personally. Every one of us individually are a part of to make a people of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
You are a royal priesthood.
Amen.
You are a peculiar people. Amen. You are of God and personally of God. You following me?
Sure.
So we have a purpose. We have proof. We have a prospect. We have a precious prize. We have a present presentation. We have a profound problem. And we are a peculiar priesthood.
Amen.
Peculiar.
Yes, sir.
You're set apart.
Yes, sir.
You should be different.
Right.
Amen.
You're not just like everybody else.
Right.
The Lord doesn't want you like everybody
That's
else.
Right.
And I'm not trying to obtain a corruptible crown.
Yes, sir.
I am working towards an incorruptible
yes,
crown.
Yep.
And I can't obtain an incorruptible crown by making you happy.
Right.
I will only obtain an incorruptible crown by making him happy.
Amen.
And so trying to live good and trying to live godly, two different things.
Right.
Completely different things. It's all well and good to do good. It's appropriate to do right. It's morally conscious to do right. But it's not enough for God.
Amen.
That's right.
He has called you to be a peculiar people. He has called you to set apart yourself. He has called you to be separate from everybody else because you are not like everybody else.
That's right.
Amen.
And praise God for that.
Amen.
Because not everybody else gets the precious prize.
Amen.
And so if I'm trying daily to live right unto my fellow man, but I am not being mindful nor paying attention to my God,
right,
I fail.
Amen.
You can live good and not live holy, and you may be well and good to the person beside you, but to God, he says your righteousness is a filthy rag.
Yes, sir.
You've got to understand the difference. You're supposed to be good. You're supposed to be right, but you're not supposed to stop there. That's not where it ends.
Yes, sir.
You don't end at doing good. You don't end at doing right. I'm not trying to get what the world has for me. I'm trying to get what God has for me.
Amen.
Because I'm not trying to reach what's next to me. I'm trying to reach what I can't see. Because he's got it ready for me.
Amen.
You with me?
Yes, sir.
Verse 10. Which in time past were not a people. You realize before Christ, you were a nothing with a zero rubbed out?
That's right.
Yep. You were a zero.
Yes, sir.
And the ring around it was rubbed out. Mm-hmm. That's all you had to offer God.
Right.
That's what it's saying here. Which in time past were not a people. You were not a nothing. You were non-existent. You didn't form yourself from the dust of the ground.
Right.
You did not come through the womb of your mother.
Yes, sir.
You did not place yourself there by intuition and good thoughts.
Right.
You didn't put yourself there with your own intuitions. God did it for you.
Yes, sir.
And before you came along, he was.
Amen.
And he took you and made you personally of God.
Amen.
That's a strong preposition of. We are people of the book. We are people
right.
of God.
Right.
Of. I am a part of to make whole God.
What a truth. Amen. Yes, sir.
Which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
Amen.
There was a time where I was living a life without Christ and I was striving to be a good citizen.
Right.
Get a good job, get a good career going for myself, get a good family,
right.
Hey, have a nice place to live. Put a nice car in the driveway that we could get place A to B and not have to worry about breaking down and represent myself well when I went out in public and make sure I didn't look like a slouch or a bum. Make sure that my breath didn't stink when I'm trying to have conversations with good people. Make sure I help my neighbor rake the leaves when they rake the leaves, shovel the driveway when it snows, and just be a good person. Hallelujah.
Right.
But if I stopped there,
right.
I have failed.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Because he didn't call me to be of the people. He called the people to be of God.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Amen.
Are you with me? Mm-hmm. You follow me?
Yeah.
So here's point number, whatever that is. A pitied people. Not a pitiful people. A pitied people. God thought enough about you to make you a certain people of himself that he gave you mercy you didn't deserve.
Right.
And he shed pity on you. To be a people when you didn't deserve it.
Amen.
Christ died for you not because you raked your neighbor's yard,
right.
Not because you shoveled your neighbor's driveway, not because you helped the little old lady with the groceries to the car, not because you gave money to the church, not because you were just a good person and the community loved you. He pitied you when you didn't deserve it.
Yes, sir.
And he didn't just call you to be a good person. He called you to be people of God. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
God told us we used to be a nothing, and now we're everything.
Amen.
Amen.
Before Christ, I was a zero with the ring rubbed out. But with Christ, I am now not being a people before, but now today, I'm a people of God. Hallelujah. The things I used to do, I don't do them. Not because I have to, but because I want to. I didn't quit doing things because I didn't enjoy them.
Right. Right.
I quit doing things because he called me to be a certain people.
Yes, sir.
He called me to be a peculiar people. He told me I'm a royal priesthood. He told me he had expectations of me.
Right.
And it wasn't just to be a good person. That's table stakes. Being a good person, morally right, and doing good in your community and doing good as a citizen, that's just table stakes. Those are the basics. That's a flank steak put on the table, cooked well done, you just eat it. It's supposed to be normal.
Right.
That's normal.
Right.
But I didn't just call you to be a people.
Amen.
I called you to be a people of God. Next level. Take it up a notch. I'm not just a person. I'm not just a thought in one's mind. I'm not just a mom or a dad. I'm not just a brother or sister. I'm not just a friend or foe. I am a precious, peculiar, particular, presently now, people of God.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Amen. I am a people of God. Amen. I'm not going to be just a
right.
people of God. I am
right.
a people of God. I'm not just your brother. I am a people of God and I'm your brother. I am not just a pastor. I am a people of God and
yes.
your pastor. I am not just a person in the community. I am a people of God personally in the community.
Amen.
Big difference. You can live good and morally right and high five to you. But if you're not living godly, you
right.
have failed.
Amen.
And you have fallen short. I am a part of something that completes a whole. And I am in the whole of God. The people of God must always remember and live in a manner of the fact that they are indeed of God. Your home should be run in such a manner that you're not just a good mom, that you're not just a good dad, that you're not just a good sibling, that you're not just a good brother or sister or aunt or uncle. You're not just a good person. Your home, your workplace, your attitude,
yes.
your spirit, everything about you should be, I am
yes,
a people of God.
Amen.
I'm not just a person. I'm not just another good old boy. I'm not just a good lady in the community.
Right.
I am a people of God.
Amen.
Brother Burwell preached a powerful message to me at my ordination service. I love the message because it reminded me of a thought that I failed on oftentimes. He said, you are not just a pastor. You are the man of God for Prince Frederick. And I don't live up to it. I'm not saying that I'm good enough for it. I'm not saying I deserve it. God knows I don't deserve it. But I've got to recognize
yes,
my
sir.
Position in the fact that I am called to be.
Amen.
I am personally the man of God that God has called to this place.
That's good.
Amen.
But I take that and I flip it on you.
Right.
And say, you are
yes.
a people of God for this place.
Yes, sir.
You are a person of God for this place. You are not just called to be a person.
Right.
You are not just called to be good. You are called to be a people of God for Prince Frederick.
Yes, sir.
Do you follow me?
Yes, sir.
You are not just for yourself. You are bought with a price.
Amen.
And he paid to use you. You are supposed to be a people of God, not just a people.
Amen.
We surpassed just a people a long time ago.
Right.
The day you got saved,
right.
you stepped into a realm
yes, sir.
That you didn't even know existed.
Amen.
And now you have a responsibility, and Peter's trying to teach these people how to be a certain people. And he says, you are a royal priesthood. You are a peculiar people. You're not just any old Joe Blow. You are a person of God, and he wants us to live like people of God.
That's good.
So where does everything you do begin? The people of God always begin at God. What do I mean by that? Everything you do, every reason you breathe, should not start with what you think, but what he thinks.
Amen.
I didn't begin at me. I began at him. Does that make sense? Before him, I was nothing. I was destined to hell, and that's where I was going to go forever.
Right.
But when I became part of him, that's when I became something.
Amen.
You follow? And when I became something, I began at God. Without God, I was nothing.
That's right.
When he got there, when he came in here,
yes, sir.
Changed everything. You with me?
Amen.
So you are a people of God. And don't ever forget who you are.
Amen.
And when you live your life today, tomorrow, and the days after, you ought not just live your life as a good old boy. You ought to live your life as a person of God.
Amen.
Because you are a people of God. Begin at God in your day. Begin at God in your marriage. Begin at God in your parenting. Begin at God in your job. Begin at God in your neighborhood. Nothing of God comes without beginning at God.
Amen.
Yeah. If you fall short in this category of life, and if all you're trying to do is just to be a good old boy, you're going to fall short on everything God has for you.
That's right.
Amen.
You'll get some of it, but you ain't going to get all of it.
Amen.
Because in order to be of God, your life must begin at God. My day starts with God.
Yes, sir.
My purpose is beginning at God.
Yes, sir.
I'm not just going to work tomorrow to earn a dollar.
Right.
I'm not just going to work tomorrow to put food on the table. I'm going to work tomorrow at God. Because I am a people of God. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
You're not just called to be of yourself. You're called to be a people of God. Let's stand together.